Hello students, welcome to this another discussion video on the topic inventory cost flows. In this particular lesson, you should be able to determine the value of any inventory and cost of goods sold using different cost formulas. Before we discuss the cost formulas, let us first understand the flow of the goods that we are selling in our operations. So if you can still recall, if you're going to add your beginning inventory and your purchases for the period, you will arrive at the goods available for sale. So itong goods available for sale na to, dalawa lang ang possible na endpoint nito. So first is yung hindi sila mabebenta. So if it will remain unsold at the end of the accounting period or if it will be sold at the end of the accounting period. Now, kapag siya ay unsold, so in short, ito yung mga items na hindi natin nabenta. So, unsold items, unsold goods shall be presented in your statement of financial position as your merchandise inventory end. So, yun yung ating ipipresent sa ating asset section. Whereas, kapag sold naman ang goods available for sale, ang ating amount na yan ay mapupunta sa income statement. And that will be in the form of cost of goods sold, which will be deducted from revenue for us to get our gross profit. Now, considering that circumstance or situation, our question mark, our big question is, how much will be the peso value of your inventory or your cost of goods sold? Considering plus that from time to time, di ba, magpa-purchase yung entity, for example. And it is really common and usual lang talaga yan na, for example, yung purchase price na nabili mo ngayon is different from the purchase price na binili mo some other time. So, in short, there is fluctuations in the cost or the unit cost of the inventories that you purchase. So, since ganun yung setup, say for example, your inventory, you're purchasing canned goods, for example. So, the other week, no, bumili ka from the mall, for example, it only cost you 17 pesos, for example. Now, the next week naman, the following week, yun, no, bumili ka ulit. This time, the cost is 18 pesos na. Now, mamamablema ka or magiging concern mo kung magkano ba ang value na i-assign mo sa mga goods or inventory that are still on hand. And magkano kaya yung cost ng mga goods na naibenta mo na. So, to address that problem, that is why in this particular lesson, we will be discussing cost formulas. So, itong cost formulas na to, ito yung tutulong sa atin para maging systematic yung pag-assign natin ng peso value sa ating merchandise inventory end. And ultimately, you'll be able to compute na rin your cost of goods sold. So, what are these cost formulas? So, as I've mentioned again, these cost formulas will help us assign the peso value to our inventories. So, according to PAS 2, the value of inventory can be determined using the following cost formula. So, take note, dalawa lang ang cost formulas na recommended ni PAS number 2. Na as per provision, only FIFO or first in, first out and weighted average methods are provided or expressly recommended in our PAS 2 standards. We also have other cost formulas. We have LIFO or last in, first out And then the other one is the specific identification. So, isa-isahin natin i-discuss yung mga cost formulas. First is your first in, first out na cost formula. So, ano bang meron dito sa first in, first out? So, in this particular method, it assumes that the goods first purchased are first sold. So, ano yung first in, so meaning first purchased, we assume that they are also the ones who are first sold. This is in accordance with the ordinary merchandising procedure that goods sold in the order they are purchased. Again, this is in accordance with the ordinary merchandising procedure that goods sold in the order that they are purchased. So they are sold in order or in the order that they are purchased. So usually talaga kapag ikaw ay negosyante, unahin mong ibenta yung mga older purchases mo, no? Para maging, of course, bago yung iyong inventory on hand. Kasi yun yung ideal, di ba, na yung una nating nabili, yun yung dapat ang una nating ibenta. So, therefore, in this particular method, inventory is expressed in recent or new prices, and the cost of goods sold is representative of earlier or old prices. So just take note, class, that in this particular cost formula, we are not really into the physical flow of the inventory. What we're doing here is just an assumption. You have just assumed, no, that the goods that were first purchased are the first sold. In this first in, first out. So, regardless of the actual situations, hindi mo talaga in-identify, hindi mo talaga dinetermine kung saan ba galing yung goods na nauna mong nabenta, no? Galing ba sila doon talaga sa older purchases or not? So, you did not really determine that in the first in, first out method. This is just a way of assigning peso amount to your inventory. So, in short, nag-a-assume lang tayo that ito mga inventory na natira, so ito yung mga inventories or goods that we purchased recently. No? Ito yung mga goods na pinurchased natin recently because we're assuming that yung mga nabenta ay galing sa older, no, or earlier na purchases. So this particular method favors the statement of financial position since inventory is stated at current replacement cost. Kasi nga, di ba, ina-assume natin na ang ending inventory galing sila sa recent purchases. So most probably, yung presyo noon, ang price noon ay yun talaga yung current, no, na prices. So, inventories will be stated really at current replacement cost and which will be presented in your statement of financial position. However, the objection of this particular method is that there is improper matching of cost against revenue. Why? Because goods are sold, or since goods sold are stated at earlier or older prices, resulting in understatement of cost of goods sold. Kasi nga, di ba? If the ending inventory, we are assuming that galing sila sa recent purchases, meaning, consequently, ang ating cost of goods sold will be stated based on the older prices. So, there is no proper matching of cost against revenue. Kasi most probably yung selling price mo will be adjusted based on your recent purchases. So, there's no matching talaga of your cost against their related revenue. So, therefore, in this method class, na in the period of inflation or rising prices, no, pataas yung mga presyo ng mga bilihin, the FIFO method would result to the highest net income. Bakit? Kasi you will be, if the prices are rising, ibig sabihin, diba, yung merchandise inventory end mo, they will be reported at higher prices. So kung malaki yung or mataas yung presyo na inassign natin sa ating inventory, and if you can still recall the formula of computing your cost of goods sold, di ba, that is beginning inventory plus purchases minus your merchandise inventory end mo. So malaki yung dinidak mo. It will result that your cost of goods sold will be lower. So pag maliit yung cost of goods sold natin, of course, maliit lang yung amount na i-deduct natin sa ating sales. So therefore, you will be reporting a higher na gross profit. And then ultimately, it will result to the highest net income. So that is kapag inflation, no, pataas yung presyo. Now, kapag baliktad naman, in the period of deflation or declining prices, FIFO method would result to the lowest net income. Bakit? Kasi yung merchandise inventory mo na account are stated in the recent prices, which is lower. So, maliit lang ngayon ang value ng merchandise inventory mo na i-deduct mo doon sa total goods available for sale, which will result to a highest na which will result to the highest na cost of goods sold. So, pag malaki yung cost of goods sold natin, then yung i-deduct natin doon sa ating sales will be, of course, malaki din. So, kung malaki yung dinidact natin na sa sales, na as cost of sales, you will be reporting a lower gross profit. And ang result nun, re-report ka ng mas maliit na net income or profit. So let us try to illustrate, no? Paano ba ina-apply yung FIFO in assigning or in determining the peso value of your ending inventory as well as your cost of goods sold. So I have here a problem as presented kanina. This is an inventory data, no, of a certain company. So you are given the beginning balances in terms of quantity, the unit cost, and the total cost. Also, meron siyang transactions na happened for the month of January. So first, may sale siya noong January 8, 500 units. Meron siyang purchases on January 18 na 700 at 210. So, yun yung total cost niya. Meron siya ulit benta noong January 22, 800 units. And then, meron siyang purchases, 500 units at 220. So, that's a total of 110,000. So, upon physical count, it was identified, it was determined that the ending inventory, no, is 700 units. So, yung problema natin ngayon, how much value should we assign, no, to your 700 units? No? Considering nga, like for example, diba, beginning balance, tag 200 lang yung unit cost. Yung bumili siya noong January 18, nag 210 na. Noong January 31, nag 220 na. So, saan dito yung ating i-consider na value nung 700 units natin? So, if you are to apply the FIFO method, so considering that this is periodic inventory system, di ba, kapag periodic inventory system, ma-establish lang natin yung merchandise inventory end kapag tayo ay nag-physical count. So ngayon, meron ka ng physical count. Ang physical count mo, 700 units. If you're going to apply FIFO, FIFO, first in, first out, most probably, these 700 units here are coming from your January 31 purchase. So, yung 700 units mo, 500 of that now were coming from your January 31 purchase. So, that is why here, no, this is the assigning of peso value to your merchandise inventory at the end of January. So, from those purchases, no, galing ng January 31, that's 500 units times 220 unit cost. Again, this is coming from here. So you just multiply it 500 times 220, you will get your 110 pesos or 110,000 pesos. And then since kulang pa, 'di ba kasi 700 units 'yun, kulang pa ng 200. So saan ba galing yung 200 units na 'yan? So galing 'yan naman sa next recent purchase, which is January 18. So yung natirang 200, we are assuming that galing siya sa 210 or itong purchases nung January 18, which has a unit cost of 210. So that is why we are assigning here 210 a peso value. So that's 200 times 210, a total of 42,000. So pagdating, of course, no, since kompleto na yung 700 units natin, what we can do here is just add yung total cost ng ating merchandise inventory. So it turned out that the value of the 700 units which are on hand as of December 31 is 152,000. So again, yung breakdown niya galing sa January 31 na purchases tsaka galing sa January 18 na purchases. So that's the total, 152,000. When we compute for the cost of goods sold under periodic inventory system, so ganito lang, di ba kasi this is how we compute really our cost of goods sold, if you can still recall in your basic accounting. So we'll start with the beginning inventory, and then we add the purchases from January 18, purchases from January 31. So that's a total of 257,000 yung total purchases natin. So if you're going to add your total purchases plus your beginning inventory, so you will get your total goods available for sale at 417,000. So after that, we deduct the inventory end or the inventory on January 31 as we have computed previously, that's 152,000. So your cost of goods sold will be 265,000. Now, so that's your total cost of goods sold. So that's for the periodic inventory system. Kasi nga, yung periodic inventory system, magdi-determine lang naman tayo ng value ng inventory natin at the end of the period after you have conducted your physical count. Okay, so let us proceed to the perpetual. So what is perpetual? Now, take note class na kapag perpetual inventory system siya, every time that you have a sale, diba yung recent na purchase mo, yun yung paggagalingan ng iyong goods na binenta. No? So yun yung basis ng iyong cost of goods sold. So for example here, same problem, except that this time, apply natin yung perpetual inventory system. Now, how do we assign, how do we determine the inventory value? So dito, ganun pa rin, no, that you're going to check on the flow of your goods. No? Kaso lang dito sa perpetual inventory system, kailangan mo talagang i-trace, i-monitor yung flow ng goods. Kasi nga, dito, every time meron kang sale, you have to recognize cost of goods sold. So, in answering your perpetual inventory system, I would prefer na i-establish ko muna yung cost of goods sold, no? Para mas madali siya. Like, for example, bakit ko gustong unahin yung cost of goods sold? Kasi every time there is a sale, no, magko-compute ka niyan, no, kung magkano ba yung cost of sale mo. Not unlike, no, or unlike your periodic inventory system na pwede na lang ang cost of goods sold ay compute mo at the end of the accounting period when you have already established your inventory end. Na, so here, just to illustrate, yung cost of goods natin na computation, the perpetual way of doing it actually is ganito. Diba nung January 8, meron siyang sale na 500 units. So yung 500 units na yan, kasi noong January 8, wala pa namang purchases, di ba? So yung 500 units na yan, most probably, galing yan doon sa January 1 na balanse na 800 units. So ibig sabihin, yung January 8 sale are coming from your January 1 beginning inventory. So that's 500 units times 200 pesos. So that's a total of 100,000. So yan, di ba? Itong beginning balance mo dito, meron ka na lang 300 units na natira. Now, noong January 22 na sale, 800 units yun. So, saan galing yung 800 units na yun? So, sabi natin, first in, first out. So, unahin natin i-charge or unahin natin ibenta yung ating beginning inventory. So, this one, yung 800 units na to, since meron nang na-deduct na 500, ang natira na lang ay 300 units. So, unahin natin ibenta yung 300 units. So, times 200, that will be 60,000. And the remainder or yung remaining units will be coming from your January 18 purchases. So, yung 800 man ito, so minus 300, so yung 500 galing sa January 18 na purchase. So, that's 500 units times 210. A total of 105,000. So, kung tinignan natin, your total cost of goods sold would be 265,000. So if you have noticed, it's just the same with your periodic inventory system. So we can generalize class that if you are using FIFO method, even if your inventory system is periodic or perpetual, no, yung gamit natin, it will not matter. The same lang ang kanilang ending na the same lang kanilang ending inventory na mare-report at saka yung cost of goods sold na mare-report. So, going back, kasi ito yung kinumpute natin una, yung cost of goods sold. Diba? So, ngayon, dito tayo sa ating ending inventory. So, kung titingnan natin ulit, no, ano na lang man ang mga natira? So, for sure, ang natira yung sa January 31 na purchase na 500 units, so that's 110,000. And yung natira galing sa January 18 purchase, kasi diba ito, 700 minus 500, no, yung nabenta natin noong January 22. So, 200 na lang times 210, so you'll have 42,000, a total of 152,000. Again, regardless of the inventory system na gamit, kapag FIFO method ang ating in-apply, the same lang ang kanilang i-report na peso value ng inventory natin saka ng cost of goods sold. So, that will be for the FIFO na cost formula. So, next is, the next method is this one, the weighted average method. So, weighted average method can be applied in a periodic inventory system or a perpetual inventory system. So, unahin na muna natin yung periodic inventory system. So, pag periodic inventory system ang gamit class, what we have really to compute first is itong tinatawag natin na weighted average cost per unit. So, how do we compute the weighted average cost per unit? So, that is computed as your total goods available for sale in terms of peso value. You divide it by your total goods available for sale in terms of units or quantity. So, kapag na-compute na natin ito, madali na lang kasi the cost of inventory is just equivalent to your weighted average cost per unit multiplied by the total number of inventory. And so, yan yung ating value ng inventory. Sa cost of goods sold naman, what you have to do is you simply multiply din yung weighted average cost per unit natin by the number of items or goods that we're able to sell. So, yun yung ating i-report na cost of goods sold. Or, the other way of doing it is pareho din doon sa FIFO method na i-apply natin yung formula na beginning inventory plus purchases equals TIGAS minus your merchandise inventory and as determined using the weighted average method under periodic inventory system so that you will get your cost of goods sold. So again, let's have an illustration here under the weighted average periodic. So this is how you are going to apply no, the weighted average in a periodic inventory system. So first what we have to determine is your total goods available for sale in terms of peso value and in terms of number of units. So we started with your beginning inventory. So we're still using the same data of information no? Doon sa FIFO. The same lang ito nung data na ginamit natin sa FIFO method. So you'll start with your merchandise inventory beginning. So ito yung beginning balances, quantity, number of quantity, the unit cost, and then the total cost. Ito total cost ito. This one is your quantity or the number of units, and this one is your unit cost. Okay? So your purchases inad lang. So your total goods available for sale in terms of quantity or number is 2,000 units. And in terms of peso value, we have 417,000. So if you have this already, what you have to do is you just compute your weighted average cost per unit. And how do you do that? That is just your TIGAS peso value divided by TIGAS in quantity or number of units. So 417,000, you divide it by 2,000, you will get 208 pesos and 50 centavos. Paano mag-compute ng inventory? And so madali lang, no? Kasi meron ka ng weighted average cost per unit, ang gagawin lang natin, that amount will be multiplied by the number of inventory at the or on hand at the end of the accounting period, which is January 31. So that 700 units times 208.50, it will give us 145,950. Pag-compute naman sa cost of goods sold, madali lang din. No? So, since, paano natin na-determine yung 1,300? So, looking at the information, diba, ang kanya dong sale is 500 plus 800. So, that's 1,300. Or other way of computing your number of units na sold, that's 2,000 minus the ending inventory of 700. So, that's 1,300. So, 1,300 units times your weighted average cost per unit na 208.50, it will give us 271,050, which is considered as the cost of goods sold. So, in short, this is the shortcut, no, of the short way of computing your cost of goods sold. Other way will be the traditional way of computing your cost of goods sold, wherein you'll start with the beginning inventory, you add the purchases, you'll have your total goods available for sale, and then you deduct your inventory at the end of your accounting period. In this case, that's January 31. So, this is based on our computation kanina. So, 145,950 yung kanyang inventory end. So, this will be your cost of goods sold. So, it's just the same sa kanina natin na way of computing. So, mas madali ito na, na pag-compute ng cost of goods sold. Pero, careful lang kapag merong mga decimal places. No? Kasi baka merong difference sa pag-round off ng numbers. So, that's periodic inventory system. Or susunod natin na discuss classes yung weighted average under perpetual inventory system or ang tinatawag natin na moving average method. So, bakit siya tinatawag na moving average method? Kasi in this method class, you have to compute now for a new weighted average cost per unit every time there is a purchase and purchase return. So, kapag mayroong purchase and purchase return, automatic yan. Magko-compute ka ng bagong weighted average cost per unit. And that new weighted average cost per unit, ayun yung gagamitin mo as your basis kapag meron kang sale, no? O kapag meron kang mga nabentang goods. So, the cost of inventory is just equivalent to your weighted average cost per unit, yung recent na computation mo after a purchase or a purchase return, and then multiply it by the number of inventory on hand. So, that's how you do periodic or moving average method or weighted average na perpetual inventory system. So, ano yung advantage ng weighted average perpetual? So, this is relatively easy to apply and it produces inventory valuation that approximates na, the current value if there is a rapid turnover of inventory. Na. So, at least makuha mo yung average na current value kapag pag marami kang purchases, for example. Kasi mabilis yung turnover ng inventory mo, mabilis kang makabenta, tsaka of course, pag may benta ka na, bibili ka ulit. So, pag merong purchases kasi, or merong transactions na purchases, at tsaka purchase return, so you can compute for a new weighted average cost per unit. So, that is why, parang at least, hindi man siya exactong current value, yung inventory, at least it approximates no, your current value. Ano yung disadvantage? There may be considerable lag between the current cost and the inventory valuation since the average unit cost involves earlier prices. So, yan naman no, yung disadvantage na. Kasi nga, kung hindi naman mabilis yung turnover ng inventory, so most probably, say for example, wala kang recent na purchases, of course, you wouldn't expect na merong bago na weighted average cost per unit na mako-compute. So with that, baka yung cost ng inventory natin, yung unit cost inventory natin, most probably ay magkagaling siya or magbibi siya sa mga older pa na prices. So when prices are rising, the inventory valuation will be less than the current cost. Tama, no? Pag mataas masyado yung presyo or pataas ang prices ng mga inventory, most probably, your inventory, which is based on the weighted average cost per unit, will be less than the current cost. So, mas maliit siya. Kasi nga, i-approximate niya lang. So, since madadrag yung ating weighted average cost per unit sa older na prices, so most probably yung weighted average cost per unit will be lesser compared to the current cost of the inventory. So in that case, magiging ma-understate yung ating inventory based on the current cost. So when prices are declining, the cost of the inventory will be more than the current cost. Kulang ng current cost. They will be more than the current cost. Bakit? Kasi pagpababa yung mga presyo ng inventory natin, parent replacement cost will be lower. Pero since ang mga older prices na wherein i-average man natin ito, ay matataas pa ang presyo or higher pa ng mga amount, so most probably, pag average niyan, pagkuha ng average niyan, it will result that your average weighted or the weighted average cost per unit will be greater as compared to the current cost which is now in lower na prices. Kasi hindi naman talaga siya mag-equivalent doon sa current cost since you are competing for the average of your unit cost. So again, let us have an illustration using the problem na ginamit kanina sa FIFO. So, dito sa weighted average method under the perpetual inventory system, this is how you are going to apply, no? This is how you are going to assign the value of your inventory. So first, of course, I'll start with the beginning, balance. This is your quantity, this is your unit cost, this is your total cost. So we have here, on January 8, there was a sale of 500 units. So most probably, that 500 units, of course, is galing dun sa beginning balance. Since wala pa namang purchases, yung unit cost na applicable would also be or would still be 200 pesos. So that's 500 times 200, that's 100,000. So you have a balance of 300 units and 60,000 pesos. Noong January 18, merong purchase. So since merong purchase na 700 at 210, that's 147,000. So since meron tayong purchase class, no, kailangan nating mag-compute ng bagong weighted average cost per unit. So that is, diba, yung quantity natin ay 1,000. Yung total cost natin ay 207,000. So ang gagawin natin, mag-compute tayo ng weighted average cost per unit. That's 207,000 divide 1,000. So in this case, we have 207 pesos. So itong 207 pesos na to, ito na yung weighted average cost per unit na gagamitin natin kapag merong subsequent na sale. So in this case, merong sale na nangyari noong January 22, 800 units. So yung 800 units na yon, ang i-assign natin na weighted average cost per unit, of course, is 207. So that's a total of 165,600. So yung balance natin ulit, you have 200 na lang yung natira and 41,400. Then next will be the purchases on January 31. So dagdag tayo ng 500 at 220, that's 110,000. So since meron tayong new purchases, what you're going to do is again, you have to compute for a new weighted average cost per unit. So in this case, that's 216. Actually, ano to, di ba? Meron itong decimal pa, that's 216.29. Pero i-round off na lang natin to 216. So that's a total of 151,400. Again, 216 pesos is computed as 151,400 divide 700 units. So yan, no, kapag weighted average na perpetual or moving average method, every time there is a purchase and a purchase return, kailangan natin mag-compute ng bagong weighted average cost per unit. Now, kung tatanungin, magkano na ba ang cost of goods sold natin? So, pag-compute ng cost of goods sold dito sa perpetual inventory system, madali lang. Kasi, di ba, meron naman tayong na-specify dito or nag-compute naman talaga tayo ng cost of sales every time there's a sale. So, therefore, yung cost of sale or cost of goods sold amounting to 1,300 units is composed of first yung sale ng January 8 na 100,000 tsaka yung sale ng January 22 which is 165,600 for a total of, so ang total niyan, you'll have January 8 na sale. So the amount is 100,000. And then, for the January 22 sale, the amount is 165,600. So, in short, that's a total of 265,200. So, this is your total cost of goods sold under the perpetual inventory system or moving average method. So, those are the two inventory or cost formulas which are recommended by PES number 2, no? So yun lang yung mga allowed allowed, no, per accounting standards or Philippine accounting standards number 2. Yung FIFO, tsaka yung weighted average methods. Now, let us just discuss, no, just for the purpose of knowing what is this or why is it that this standard, does that favor the application of this last in, first out or LIFO na method. Let's just discuss, no, its concepts. So, this LIFO or last in, first out, no, ang assumption dito class ay goods which are purchased last or goods last purchased are first sold. So, yun yung assumption dito, no? Last in, first out. Yung latest mo na purchases, yun yung first mo na ibibenta. So, therefore, goods remaining at the end of the period are those first purchased or produced. So, yung ano talaga, no? Ang matitira ay yung mga latest or old pa na purchases. So, inventory is expressed in terms of earlier or old prices and the cost of goods sold is representative of recent or new prices. So, this favors income statement because there is matching of current cost against current revenue. So, since the cost of goods sold will be stated at the recent or new prices, so there is really matching, no, of the revenue, your sales revenue against the cost of goods sold. Objection against LIFO is that since inventory is stated at earlier or older prices, there may be significant lag between inventory valuation and the current replacement cost. Tama, di ba? Kasi ang cost ng iyong inventory end ay magbabase pa sa old pa talaga ng mga prices. So, say for example, most probably, yung beginning inventory mo na cost, yun din yung magiging ending inventory mo. Kasi, you're assuming that ang unang mababenta ay yung mga recent na purchases. So, malamang, ang matitira is yung mga older na purchases or baka pa talaga yung beginning inventory, yun pa yung matitira na inventory. So, this LIFO permits income manipulation. Paano gagawin yun na namamanipulate ang income? So, by making year-end purchases designed to preserve existing inventory layers. No, so, kung gusto mo na ang iyong inventory end ay lower amount, for example, kung gusto mo lower amount yung inventory end mo, then ang gagawin mo lang ay bibili ka, no, towards the end of the accounting period para ang ma-report na cost of sales ay magbibase doon sa iyong recent na purchases. Tapos yung inventory end ay galing doon or galing sa mga old mo na purchases or sa beginning inventory mo. So, depende. So, kaya hindi pinipermit or hindi nire-recommend, no, ng standard na gamitin ang LIFO. Kasi there is really a chance na ma-manipulate ang income, no, based on para makapag-strategize, no, yung entity na maging favorable sa kanya yung result ng operations. So, in the period of rising prices, the LIFO method would result to the lowest net income. Whereas in the period of declining prices, the LIFO method would result to the highest net income. So, gusto ko lang i-emphasize again na hindi ito recommended ng standard, pero just for the purpose of presenting, no, the concept kung bakit hindi siya applicable or bakit hindi siya recommended ng standard. So, we will just discuss this. So, here's an illustration pertaining to LIFO. So, ganun dun. Periodic tsaka perpetual. So, pag LIFO ang gamit, for example, dito, diba, ang beginning inventory niya, ang ending inventory niya ay 700 units. So, kung LIFO, ibig sabihin, mga recent, yung mga sales niya ay galing sa mga recent na purchases. So, in short, yung 1,300 na purchase, kasi this is just the same problem that we have used, no, in the earlier methods. So you have yung CO natin na 1,300, most probably galing siya dito, 500 plus 700, so that's 1,200. So 100 lang yung nakuha doon sa beginning balance. So kung LIFO method ang gamit, ang ending balance mo ay galing pa rin sa beginning balance, which is 200 ang kanyang value or peso or cost per unit. So your inventory will be 140,000. So yun under sa LIFO, no, periodic. So pag-compute ng cost of goods sold, so using the traditional method of computing your cost of goods sold, so yung formula natin na beginning inventory plus purchases equals total goods available for sale minus inventory end. So your cost of goods sold will be 277,000. So that's under LIFO, no, na periodic inventory system. Kung perpetual naman, so ganito, no, unahin muna natin yung cost of goods sold, no, kasi ganito siya. Say for example, ang January 8 na sale. So yan, no, 500. So malamang yung 500 na yan na sale galing siya sa beginning balance, no, if you are again applying perpetual inventory system. So yung January 8 na sale galing siya sa inventory ng January 1. So that's 100,000. Yung sa January 22 naman, na 800, galing siya dito sa purchases ng January 18, 700, saka 100 galing sa beginning balance. So, this is the computation of the cost of goods sold, no? From 18 or January 18 purchase, that's 700 units times 210, 147,000. And from the inventory sa January 1, 100 times 200, so that's 20,000. So, your total cost of goods sold noong January 22 na sale is 167,000. So, with that, the total cost of goods sold is 267,000. So, yun yung ating cost of goods sold. So, kung babalikan natin, magkano ba ang value noong ending inventory na 700 under LIFO method? So, most probably, ang 700 units ay galing sa January 31 na purchase. That's 110,000. And yung natira, no, galing sa beginning inventory na 200 pesos. Kasi diba, meron ng sale na 500, so 300 ang natira. Tapos yung sale ng January 22, merong 100 na nakuha doon sa January 1 na balance. So ang natira na lang is 200. Times 200 pesos, I'll have 40,000. So that's a total of 150,000. Yun yung ending inventory natin under LIFO method. So again, I just like to emphasize, no, i-repeat ko lang na LIFO method is not acceptable per PES number 2, no, or the standards applicable for inventories. So hindi siya po pwedeng gamitin. Let us discuss the other method of assigning value or determining the value of your inventory. So this one is the specific identification. So in this particular method class, very particular talaga ito, no, sa physical flow of the inventory. So here, specific costs are attributed to identified items of inventory. The cost of inventory is determined by simply multiplying the units on hand with their actual unit cost. So for this to be for this to work, no, so meaning you really have to monitor. Wait, teka lang, no, alin bang inventory ang binenta? Para you can specifically identify the actual cost of the inventory on hand and sold. So appropriate, no, or this is appropriate for inventories that are segregated for a specific project and inventories that are not ordinarily interchangeable, no, para ma-determine or ma-specifically identify mo talaga sila. The advantage of this particular method is that the flow of the inventory cost really corresponds with the actual physical flow of goods. Hence, there is an actual determination of cost of units sold and on hand. Kasi iniisa-isa mo talaga, no, trinis mo talaga na ito yung nabenta, galing dito yung na-purchase na units, no? So, itong benta na to galing dito sa purchases na ito. So, you can really identify the actual cost of your items. Ang disadvantage lang niya, it's very costly to implement kasi you really have to strictly monitor the physical flow of your inventory para matrace mo kung saan galing purchases yung goods na nabenta mo for a particular sale. So, another concepts pertaining to cost or unit cost or cost of inventory. So, we have here standard cost. So, pag sinabi natin standard cost, classes are predetermined product cost. So, pag sinabi natin product cost, we're referring actually to inventoryable cost na yung cost na ina-assign natin sa inventory. They are established on the basis of normal levels of materials and supplies, labor efficiency, and capacity utilization. So, standard cost is applicable or used, no, for convenience if the result approximate the or if the results approximate the cost. So, ito siya, mas applicable ito sa mga manufacturing concern kasi the determination of your cost or the determination of product cost is very vital or very important, no? And hindi siya pwedeng madeli. So, kung hintayin pa natin na matapos yung production ng goods or matapos ang pag-accumulate ng cost ng na-produce mong item, baka aabutan ka ng siyam-siyam, no? Hindi mo pa mabibenta yung goods mo kasi wala ka pang unit cost. Di mo pa alam kung ano yung basis ng selling price mo, for example. So, with that, kaya meron tayong mga siniset na mga predetermined cost or itong tinatawag natin na standard cost. This is based on experience of the entity and of course, this should be updated, no, from time to time also, especially kung naay mga increases in prices, for example. So, this will be adjusted. Another thing about this standard cost is that you can make this as your basis of evaluation or para magiging basis mo sa performance ng production team. Say, for example, yung standard cost is 100. So, tapos, pag-compare ngayon sa actual is naging 120, for example. So, you have to analyze the variance, no? San ba, ano ba ang dahilan bakit hindi nagtugba yung standard tsaka yung actual na cost na na-incur. So, that will be discussed in your higher accounting na subjects na yung standard cost. The last topic here is all about the relative sales price method. So here, this is applicable because if you purchase different commodities at a lump sum price or basket price, no? So ang gagawin lang natin, the single cost is apportioned among commodities based on the respective sales price. So we have here an illustration. So products A, B, and C are purchased at a basket price of 3 million. Assume that the said products have the following sales price. So, for product A, that's 500,000. Product B is 1.5. Product C is 3 million. So, paano natin i-compute, no, yung ang cost of product A, product B, tsaka product C? So, ang gagawin lang natin, you just get the total of the sales price ng lahat ng product, no, na nabili mo in a basket price. In this case, that's a total of 5 million. So, based on that particular sales price, we are going to formulate a fraction out of this. So, you have 5 over 50 for product A, then 15 over 50 for product B, and 30 over 50 for product C. So, paano natin yung ginawa? Tinanggal lang natin yung mga zero. So, dito nagtanggal tayo ng limang zero, no? Dapat uniform sila. Tinanggal lang yung limang zero. So, para makuha natin yung proportion. Then after that, if you have already the fraction, the next thing that you have to do is you just multiply this by your basket price, which is 3 million. Ito, di ba? Ito yung basket price niya, 3 million. So, multiply lang natin dyan. So, that's 5 over 50 times 3 million, you will get 300,000. 15 over 50 times 3 million, you'll have 900,000. 30 over 50 times 3 million, you'll have 1.8 million. So, that's a total of 3 million. So, in short, the cost of your product A will be 300,000, product B will be 900, and product C will be 1.8. So, hindi pwedeng i-record mo ta lump sum price of 3 million. So, dapat i-allocate mo talaga ang lump sum price to the commodities or the goods that you have purchased in lump sum or with lump sum price. Okay, so that will be all. So if you have questions, please free to raise that during our online class. So thank you for your patience in listening class. Bye and see you in the next video.